So the burn injury, we already had completed that Ayurvedic portion, Agnikarma. So now we just discuss the burn injury. So what is burn injury? The injury caused by the excessive heat or excessive cold. Okay, both comes in the burn injuries. The basic the pathophysiology that occurs in the burn is that basically it is the coagulative necrosis. Okay, all the kind of burn injury provide the coagulative necrosis to the tissue, so that injury that so that that the tissue is destroyed and the wound is developed in that part. Okay, so we can divide it in the two part, primarily thermal burn and non-thermal burn. Thermal burn means when the direct heat is the factor which is causing the burn, which is causing the coagulative necrosis. That is the direct heat by the flame, by that fire, or that any kind of that accidental plane crash, bombing. So these kind of things, where the direct heat or direct flame is responsible for the damaging of that tissue. And second thing, the scald, where the moist heat means the or the hot water, hot oil. Okay. So any kind of means latent heat which is destroying destroying that tissue, that is scalds. So these two comes in the thermal injury, and other the non-thermal injuries are that non-thermal injuries. Ultimately, they damage the tissue by that coagulative necrosis. But these type of injuries are that other than direct heat or the scald, that are the electric burns, chemical burns, radiation burns, and the cold burns. Okay. So let the discuss one by one. The thermal burns mostly happens in the adults, and the scalds burn mostly happens in the infants or childrens due to accidentally when the children touches. Just pour the hot water, hot milk or oil on their body. Okay, so this is the means. Just the burn is very common injuries. Most of the, so many peoples are died whole worldwide with the burn by the various accidental injuries, by various industrial burn and household burn. Okay, so. So there are we just study complete burn in the that what are the changes happens in our the bodies. Okay, so the changes happens on the two levels, one local changes and other the systemic changes. So what are the local changes that occurs after the burn injuries? That we just discuss one by one, 4 points in the local changes and 4 points the systemic changes. So in the local changes, we discuss the four things: the severity of the burn, extent of the burn, and vascular changes after the burn, and the infections. These changes happens locally where the tissue is burned. And due to this local burn, there are some systemic changes occurs in the body. That is the shock is the first things. That shock includes the hypovolemic shock, later on maybe neurogenic shock, cardiogenic shock, or that septicemic shock, bacteriemic shock, that may develops. And some other biochemical changes in our the body, some changes in the bloods, and some systemic effects. Okay, so first we discuss the local changes, where we discuss the severity of the burn. So on the basis of the severity of the burn, it is this the burn is categorized in the three degrees: first degree, second degree, and third degree. Okay, so first degree, the burns and then there is one more classification, partial thickness and full thickness. Okay, so one by one we discuss the what is first degree burn, where only that our skin has basically 7 layers, that I divided in basically two parts, epidermis and the dermis. Okay, our skin has two part, epidermis and the dermis. Okay, when the superficial part of the epidermis is only injured, not completely injured, okay, just got partial injured of the superficial of the dermis, then it is called the first degree burn. So in that degree burn, nothing significant changes happens, only there is the superficial hyperemia due to the injury, there is the burning sensation and little bit edema. Okay, so no deep burns there, no scar, the whatever the minimal scar is developed after the healing, and then that will goes itself. Okay, so no permanent scar is there, no systemic changes is there happens in the first degree burn. Okay, so no active surgical management is required for that first degree burn. Means the first degree burns, only the superficial part of the epidermis is damaged, and no other deep injury is there. So this is very means no active management is required in that area in this first degree burn. Next come to the second degree burn. So second degree burn is there where the complete epidermis is damaged and some part of that dermis is also injured. Okay, so that's on the basis of CBRT, second degree burn is divided in the mild second degree burn and the severe second degree burn. Okay, so second degree burn is that when the in the mild second degree burn, we know there is some skin appendages. Our skin has some supplementary things which support the skin skin, that are the sweat glands, sebaceous glands, hair follicles, cutaneous nerves. These are the necessary part of the skin called as dermal appendages or the skin appendages. So these are very important for the retaining of the skin in any part of the body, or the development of the skin, or the regeneration of the skin. So these parts are very, very much required, that is skin appendages. So in the second degree burn, epidermis is damaged and the some part of the dermis and the dermal appendages are also damaged. So when the epidermis is damaged and partial or the few parts of the dermal appendages are damaged, okay, so due to retaining of the few part of dermal appendages, the regeneration of the skin is possible. So in the second degree burn, in the mild second degree burn, the skin regenerates itself with the healing. Okay, so that loss of skin is not happen, that's why the during the healing that skin grafting is not required, because it skin has its dermal appendages, so it regenerates itself. So later on, no skin grafting is required. And one more thing, in second degree burn, the formation of the blisters. So this is the diagnostic criteria, that the blisters are an important characteristic feature of the second degree burn. These never present in the first degree burns, and these not present in the third degree burns. So blisters are the very important. If somebody has burn and got blisters, it means it is the second degree burn. Okay, why the blisters appears? When the epidermis is damaged and the dermis is damaged, so due to that damage of that our epidermis has no blood supply. All the bloods the blood for the nutrition and the other the diffusion is the process from by which the epidermis is taken the supply from the dermis. The dermis is having fluid supply, but epidermis has no blood supply. So the layers of the epidermis take the oxygen and all the nutrition from the dermal tissue by the diffusion only. So when the epidermis is damaged and the dermis is injured, so due to the injury, you know, when there is the injury, there is the inflammation. When there is the inflammation, there is the increased permeability of the capillaries. So due to this capillary, there is the exudations. When the capillaries permeability increases, then there is the exudation happens, means that there is the flowing of the serum from that intravascular compartment to the extravascular compartment. So that fluid, when is discharged from the intravascular compartment of the capillaries and collects in the extravascular compartments, that is the formation of the blisters. These blisters protects the skins, okay, and later on when they become dry, they form the crust and protects the skin and the cover the skin, and after the healing that get rid of itself. Okay, so here we discussing that second degree one, mild second degree one, we discuss that there is the complete epidermis and the few parts of the dermis is injured. And in the severe second degree burn, here the complete epidermis along with that damage of the dermis and the damage of the all skin appendages that include the hair follicles, sweat glands, apocrine sweat gland, eccrine sweat glands and sebaceous glands. So these dermal appendages also damaged. So with the for the complete healing, the skin is completely lost, so that skin grafting is necessary in that in these cases severe second degree burn. So basic difference between the first mild second degree burn and severe second degree burn is that the mild second degree burns include that epidermis as well few part of the dermis, but dermal appendages are remaining there. But in the severe cases, that epidermis is damaged along with the dermis and the dermal damage of the damage of the complete skin appendages also. Okay, that's why the skin grafting is necessary. So third degree burns, here the complete destruction of the epidermis, dermis, as well as the deep fascia, superficial fascia. So the muscles, tendons are both, sometimes the bones or the deep structures are exposed. So here the skin grafting is very much required due to while healing, because there is no skin remains there. So there is so much raw part is there. So to cover that part, skin grafting is required in that cases. So third degree burns has the complete damage of superficial means complete skins and that superficial fascia, deep fascia, or that muscles also may get involved. Okay, so here we have discussed the severity of the burn: first degree burn, second degree burn, third degree burn, partial thickness and full thickness. So here also partial thickness includes that first degree burn as well as the mild second degree burn. Means in the partial thickness, when we talk about partial thickness, it means the epidermis is damaged and the dermis is also damaged, but the skin appendages are intact. Okay, so the skin grafting may not require while healing. But in that full thickness burn, it means full thickness means complete skin, dermis, epidermis, and the skin, the dermal appendages completely damaged. That is equal to the severe second degree burn as well as the third degree burn. Okay, so now next come to the extent of burn, means how much amount of the body surface area is involved in the burn. It is very important to assess the extent of burn, because in every step of the management you must require that. Means how you have to manage that depends on the extent of the burn. Means how much body surface is involved, that that decided the mode of management. Okay, that decided how much fluid you have to give to the patients. Okay, so it is very important. So there are so many formulas are there to count the body surface area, out of which that rule of 9, it's very important and very easy to calculate that body surface area. So you see, but there is little difference that rule of 9 is apply only the adults. Okay, in that there is few changes in the child and the infants, because their body surface area changes. Suppose it's some old 1 year old child is there, so they have the head larger. So head has a large body surface area up to that 19%. Okay, while in an adult there is only 7%. Huh? So there is little difference. That's why you have to calculate means along with this in the children's the lower leg is 13%. One lower limb include that 13%, while in the adult it is 18%. Okay, so just for the common, the adults, you have to always remember that rule of 9, where that you can see in the pictures that face, head, neck and face, it is 9%, chest anterior 9%, abdomen anterior 9%, one limb anteriorly 9%, posteriorly 9%. Okay, the same is there. One limb 4.5% anteriorly, 4.5% posteriorly, means one limb is complete anterior posterior, then it is 9%. Okay, and the back, upper back 9%, lower back 9%. So this is the rule of 9, and that genitalia part is the 1%. Okay, so it includes the complete 100% of the body surface area. So the rule of 9 is very important and very easy to calculate also. But that's just you have to remember, if it is children, then you have to take care differently, because that to know the extent is very much essential, because that how you manage your patient. While the management, you must know the how much surface area is involved. If the if 50% area is below 50%, this surface area means along with the severity also, means that for the when we talk about the hypovolemic shock, if your pay and the IV fluids, requirement of the IV fluids, so the patient having 20% full thickness or the 40% partial thickness must require the immediate IV fluids. Okay, and that's why means this extent is to know the involved body surface is very much important. So next, there is some vascular changes happens in that in the burn cases. There is basically three changes. One, there is the dilation of the vessels due to the injury of that tissue. Due to injury of the tissue, that tissue get inflamed, that causes the dilation of the capillaries. So there is a liberation, and along with the dilation of the tissue, there is liberation of the histamine. So that's why there is liberation of there is increased the circulation of that burn area. So due to the increase of circulation and the inflammation, the pathology that happen, the inflammation is going on in that part. So increased circulation, increased capillary permeability, so that causes exudation and formation of that vesicles, there is collection of the serum inside the vesicles. Okay, and So these are the vascular changes happens in the burn injury. There is the increase dilation of the vessels due to the direct injury either by the that local injury that releasing of the histamines, the increased circulation of that that part. So these causes the formation of the blisters and the edema in that injured parts. Okay, so and these what the cause the blisters? These due to the collection of the exudate below the epidermis, there is the blister formation, and their blisters are very rich in proteins. Because this is complete serum, so high rich in protein. That's why when they dry, they form the crust. Okay, and they protect the skin. And just wait a minute. Just okay, so next there is the infections. So this is the local changes which occurs after the burn injury, after the few days injury. Initially when the burn happens, then a complete tissue is sterilized by the burn, by the heat. But later on, because that in our defense system, body defense system, that skin is the major skin has the major role to play of. Okay, when the skin is intact, then there is no issue of the defense. Okay, but when the skin is injured, this is the means the primary wall of the defense is damaged, then our tissue is exposed to get the infections. Okay, so that's why the most of the burn patients dies later due to the infections. They not die due to that burn injury. Later on, they die due to that infections previous days. But nowadays, that's why there is the specialized wards are prepared called the burn ward. So they have the all the sterilized environment. The windows are closed. There are closed rooms so that the direct entry from the air is not coming, because so much bacteria are present in the air. Suppose there's like the tetanus, it is present everywhere. Tuberculosis, it is present in air everywhere. Okay, so you to protect from these bacteria, these the fungus is everywhere. That's why you have to protect your patient, because whatever the first line defense is our body, the skin, that is not here. Okay, so what happens after the burn injury? The patient is initially, then is sterilized, then later on when it is stable and the crust, that crust are formed in the second degree burn, and when the crust get dried and there are the cracks in the crust. So from the in between the cracks, there is the raw area opens, and the virulent organism, bacteria, fungus may attack in that part, and the body get infected. Okay, and in the third degree burn, there is the open is there, complete part is no skin is there, so it is more liable to get the infection. So infection is the very important part which you always have to keep in mind while the treating of burn patients. Okay, so next thing is the systemic changes. What the systemic changes are happens. So the most important effect of the burn, more than 20% of the full partial thickness are the 20% of the partial full thickness or the 40% of partial thickness involved. That hypovolemic shock is the first thing which comes in the mind of of the treating doctor or surgeon. So this is the most common means the this is the first phenomena which is going to happen to one patient if it involve more than 20% full thickness or the 40% partial thickness, that is the hypovolemic shock. Okay, later on due to excessive pain, patient may land into the neurogenic shock, or when later on if the resuscitation is not done properly, that circulatory volume is reduced, cardiac output reduced, so cardiac filling is reduced. So and there is the increase when the burn is there, body lost so much serum, so the blood so much concentrated that that hemoglobin rise so much, hemoglobin percentage rises up to the 150%. Means the blood becomes so thick, so and that may coagulate inside the vessels, cause the sludging of the blood. So all these things may damage the cardiac tissue also. So the cardiogenic shock may also come across in the burn patients. So the primary thing is the hypovolemic shock. Later on the neurogenic shock, cardiogenic shock, and if the patient is getting the infections, then septic shock also come across in that burn patients. So there is four type of shock that may happen to the patients. So you have to always keep in mind these things. But that's why. But if you are going to control that hypovolemic shock and the controlling the pain in the patient, then you can save your patient with the cardiogenic as well as the neurogenic also. For the septic shock, you have to give the patient that sterilized environment as well as the good amount of the antibiotic covers. Okay. So next thing in the systemic changes, first thing is shock. Second is the biochemical changes. Biochemical changes, it means there is some change in the blood some chemical changes happens in the blood, just like that electrolyte imbalance. Why is where the burn injury happens, there due to that the inflammation, there is the capillary permeability is increased, so the serum is coming out from the capillaries to the extravascular compartment. So there is the sodium and chloride, it is all comes out from that blood. Okay, so it goes that level of sodium and chloride goes below in the blood, while the potassium level increase in the blood, because sludging of blood happens, means there is a clumping of that RBCs due to so much concentration. The RBCs are damaged, so that due to damages of the cells produces that increase the potassium level in the blood circulations, and there is the hypoproteinemia. While the serum is comes out from the intravascular compartment, so serum has the protein, the blood loses so much protein due to the in the form of exudations. That's why the patient may land into the hypoproteinemia. That's why the complete body swelling of the NSR come present in the burn patients. And in the burn patient, hyperglycemia is the one more thing which can happen in the burn injury. So if your patient are the diabetic diabetic patient get burn injury, then his diabetes become uncontrolled, because there is the hyperglycemia is happens in the blood that patient. So blood glucose level rises very much, so that may invite so much bacteria to catch the infections. Okay. And due to that clumping of the increasing concentration of the blood there is the blood is not able to carry enough oxygen, and the amount of blood is also come, and the concentration is also quality of blood is also not good to carry amount of the oxygen. So that's why some organs are which get ischemic. That liver and kidney, these two organs are which are very much sensitive to get hypoxemia or ischemia. So that's why there is the malfunctioning of these two organs, that liver as well as the kidney. So if the kidney is not functioning properly, then the blood urea and serum creatinine level may rise in the blood. Okay, so these are the some electrolyte imbalance, and as well as some hypoproteinemia and that hyperglycemia. These are the increased blood urea and hemoglobinuria, because the damaging of that RBCs releases so much hemoglobin in the blood, that causes the hemoglobinemia, hemoglobinuria, and there is the increase the serum creatinine level. So these are the causes, these biochemical changes that happens in the burn patients. So next, in the changes in the blood, we already discussed, due to the loss of so much serum, the concentration of blood increase so much, so that the hemoglobin may rise up to the 150, from the 15 to 150, and there is the fall in the eosinophilic counts during the first 24 hours of the burn injury, and patient may get anemia due to destruction of the RBCs, because when the blood is so much concentrated, then RBCs get clumping and that aggregate, and they causes the damage to that tissue. Okay, damage to the RBCs. Okay, so but these things never happened in the first degree burns. These always happen in the severe second degree or the third degree burns. So these times are the changes, that these are the local changes that happens in the that systemic changes that can happens in a burn patients. Okay, so these are the systemic means that overall changes happens in the burn patients. So next class will be discuss that some the systemic effect as well as the management of the burn. Okay, systemic effect means the a particular system, how particular system respond to the burn injury. So the just like GIT, that a cardiovascular system and urinary system and circulatory systems, how the particular system respond to the burn injury. So this is the lecture is finished for today. Okay, so that remaining we will discuss in the next lectures.